गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ अंशु शर्मा फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज चाकसू. आई वेलकम ऑल द सेकेंड ईयर स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ इंग्लिश लिटरेचर एंड टुडे आई शैल बी डूइंग ग्रेज एलिजी. एलिजी रिटन इन अ कंट्री चर्च यार्ड. आई हैव ऑलरेडी शेयर्ड ऑलमोस्ट 3 वीडियोज़ विद यू and I have given the introduction of the poem. Also, I have started explaining the poem along with the word meanings. We've done the first 4 paragraphs and I shall be continuing from there. Once again, yeah, this I have already done and I shall be doing the next few paragraphs today, and quickly I'll just go through the passages that I'll try and finish now. So now you can see on your screens, once again I have written the word meanings. I have written today, you can see on top, I have written one of the meanings in Hindi as well. Anyways, let me read the poem quickly. The breezy call of incense breathing morn, the swallow twittering from the straw built shed, the cock's shrill clarion or the echoing horn, no more shall rouse them from their lowly bed. For them no more the blazing hearth shall burn, or busy housewife ply her evening care. No children run to lisp their sire's return, or climb his knees the envied kiss to share. Oft did the harvest to their sickle yield, their furrow oft the stubborn gleb has broke. How jocund did they drive their team afield, how bowed the woods beneath their sturdy stroke. Let not ambition mock their useful toil, their homely joys and destiny obscure, nor grandeur hear with a disdainful smile the short and simple annals of the poor. Once again, the rhyme scheme is very clear, and you can see in the previous paragraph I had ended where the poet has mentioned how the forefathers are lying in their narrow graves, and how they led a very simple life, and the background also had been made clear as to where the poet is roaming while all these thoughts are coming to his mind. So from here we'll continue. The same idea is being continued in these paragraphs, where the poet describes the different scenes of an ordinary day, and he explains how all these activities are not any longer going to be experienced by the forefathers, by the previous generation, which is no longer alive. They are lying in their graves, they are lying in the narrow cells, and they cannot experience any of the small happiness or small joys of life. Now you can see in the first paragraph on this page, I have mentioned the different meanings. For example, what does incense mean? Incense means, Hindi mein maine likha hai agarbatti, those sticks, which are burnt for prayer, or which are also burnt in the mornings, to spread good fragrance throughout the house. So he says the breezy call of incense breathing morn. Incense breathing morn, again morning is being kind of, personified. That it breathes in the fragrant air, it breathes in the pleasant smell of the incense sticks. So basically it is an experience that all of us usually have in the mornings, when our day starts. So the breezy call of incense breathing morn, the fresh fragrant call of the morning, that cannot be experienced by these people anymore. The swallow twittering from the straw-built shed. Now this is again straw built, because this is a village that we are talking about, and the roofs of the homes are thatched, you know, they are made of straw. So from there are different small birds, they are twittering in the morning. I had explained it to you yesterday that how the birds are, you know, in the morning they are twittering, there's, you know, a lot of chatter, there is activity, and how towards the evening everything becomes dull, everyone becomes tired and they are ready to go home to sleep and rest. So here now the morning is being described, and everything that happens in the morning is being described here. The cock's shrill clarion. Clarion, clarion is a kind of a trumpet. Okay, and this is being the call of the morning. What happens? How do we wake up? We wake up when the cocks, you know, they start, they call out in the, they start cooing, they start calling out in the mornings. So we hear the echo of the clarion, we hear the echo of the huntsman. It is again, usually in the villages in the morning. I'm not talking about the present times, I'm talking about the earlier times. The huntsmen, they would go out to hunt in the mornings, and they would, you know, call people, and they would call them out by echoing, by blowing upon a horn, which indicated that it is time for everybody to gather and move towards the forest to start hunting animals for the day, animals or birds, whatever. Okay, that was their food. So he says that whether it is the clarion call, whether it is the loud sound of the horn, whether it is the twittering of the swallows, whether it is the beautiful fragrant smells of the morning, none of these things are going to make any difference to the people who are no longer alive. No more shall rouse them from their lowly bed. Lowly, lowly means a humble bed. So they are lying in their ordinary simple graves, and that is their permanent bed now. And none of these sounds, none of these smells, they are going to awaken these people who are not alive. So for them no more the blazing hearth shall burn. Now he goes on to describe the day. This is the beginning of the day. Whatever happens in the beginning of the day, none of it is going to have any impact on these people. Similarly, he says that the burning, the blazing hearth, this is the fireplace. In England, usually throughout the year, it is cold. The summers are for a very short while. Okay. So throughout it is cold, the weather is cold, and you have a fireplace is a very common thing which exists in all the households there. In India, or specifically in Rajasthan where we live, we can't think of a fireplace because our climate is very hot. So we don't usually burn fire inside our homes. Okay. But there in England, it is very cold, there is snowfall. So usually every house has a fireplace. So he says the blazing fireplace, the blazing fire is not any longer going to affect them. Or busy housewife ply her evening care. And what happens, it's the usual routine when the husbands return home after a tired, after a long day. The housewives, their wives, you know, they take care of them. They'll give them hot tea to drink, or maybe soup, or maybe good food. So the housewife is there to take care of the husband when he returns home in the evening. Ply means to give care, okay? To give care, give her care. So that also these people are not going to experience any longer. Then no children will run to lisp their sire's return. Sire means father. I have written it here. Lisp, you know, the small young children, how do they talk? They are not very articulate, and they cannot speak words very clearly. So they lisp and speak. That is again a very common occurring. So that lisping, that loving gesture of the children, that also these fathers are never going to experience. Or climb his knees, then envied kiss to share. And what happens when the father returns? Usually the children have been waiting very excitedly for their father, and maybe they expect that the father has got some gifts for them, and they will kind of, you know, try to climb on his knees, and they like to try to push each other and try to gain his attention. So envy. Usually, you know, siblings, there is sibling rivalry, you know, the brothers, sisters, they feel envious of each other. And if the father gives first, if he, you know, picks up a particular child, then the other children will start feeling jealous. So he says, the poet says that all these activities, these happy activities, the forefathers are not going to experience them again. The love of the family, the love of the wife, the love of the children, that is something which is beyond them now. Then oft means often. Now by now you must have learned these words. Oft means often. Often did the harvest to their sickle yield. Now in this paragraph, he is specifically telling us how the villagers used to, do farming, and how strong they used to be. Because farming is not an easy job, and you have to use the sickle, you have to, you know, create those furrows, you have to create those long lines in which the seeds are put, and then you have to water them, then you have to protect them from wild animals, and when then finally the crop grows, you have to harvest them, you have to store it, and then you have to sell it. It's a very long, difficult process. So here he says, often did the harvest to their sickle yield. When the harvest grew up, the sickle, they used to cut the harvest. So it very easily, you know, gave in to their effort. The furrows, often the stubborn gleb did broke. Stubborn gleb, that is land. Sometimes the land is very hard and you really have to put in a lot of effort to make it soft, to be able to plant seeds in it. So he says they were so strong that the hard land also used to break under the pressure of their sickle. Then how jocund did they drive their team afield. Jocund means happy. This is again a word which is not very frequently used now, but earlier in the earlier poetry and the earlier stories, you'll come across this word very often. So very happily they used to drive their team afield. Team is reference to the bullock cart, the pair of bulls that are, you know, used to make the furrows on the ground and to put the seeds in the ground. So that team of bulls, they used to, you know, drive them very happily, cheerfully, strongly. They would drive them onto the field to do their farm work. How about the woods beneath their sturdy stroke? So this is again a very common happening. The wild trees that grow, they are cut for firewood, or they are generally cut for making the enclosures of their fields, or making enclosures where the animals are put. So these strong wood also very easily give into the stroke of their hammer or sickle or saw, whatever instrument that they wanted to use, very easily they would use them and they would be able to cut the hard, strong wood. So this paragraph specifically tells us the ordinary, simple life of a farmer, of a village person, and also at the same time it makes it very clear that the work that they did was very difficult, it was hard, but at the same time they were strong, they were young, and they were able to accomplish their task very easily, very happily and easily. Then let not ambition mock their useful toil. Ambition, again here ambition is being personified, and very specifically, clearly the poet says that let not ambition is, what is ambition? Ambition is when you want to, you know, go places, when you want to become a very big man, when you want to become a very important person, when you want to earn a lot of money, when you want to earn some great position in life, that is ambition. So here ambition is being personified, and they say, and the poet says, what does Gray say? That let not ambition make fun of these simple villagers, of these simple people leading a simple life, growing their crop, tending to their animals, living peacefully and happily with their wives and their children. Let not ambition make fun of these simple things. And he says, their homely joys and destiny obscure. Homely joys, whatever description I have given you in these two, three paragraphs, that is what the poet is referring to. That the joy that these people derived out of their daily lives, out of their daily simple lives of earning very respectful wages, of having a loving wife, of spending time with their children, with their animals. So these are simple joys of life. And he says, let not ambition make fun of them. Then he says, and destiny obscure. Why destiny obscure? Obscure means something that is not clear, something that is not well known. And their destiny was obscure. They were not going to become a prime minister. They were not going to become very rich businessmen. So their future was obscure. Their future was not well known. Their future was going to be just like their present. It was not going to be any different. They were simple villagers. They were living the life of a villager and they would die as a villager. Right? Then he says, nor grandeur here with a disdainful smile. Grandeur, again, grandeur is reference to grand things, to impressive grand things. So he, again, grandeur also is being personified here. And here the poet says that the grand things, the grandeur should not hear with a disdainful smile. Disdainful, contemptuous, with contempt, lack of respect. So he says that, let not grand ambition make fun of their simple lives and not look upon them with a very, you know, scornful smile on their faces. You must have seen some people who are very, you know, very important, or they have a lot of money and they are full of very, they're very pompous and they are too full of themselves. And they look down upon people who are not rich or people who are not, very well-to-do or who are just ordinary, simple villagers. Some people have that tendency to look down upon such people. So the same thing is being said here, that let not rich, let not important people make fun of these simple poor villagers. The short and simple annals of the poor. Annals, record of events. Annals is basically an official record that is maintained of different things. So that is what. Now here, their simple life, the way they lived, their day-to-day activities. Now that record is extremely plain. It is extremely simple. It is not grand at all. So this is what the poet is trying to tell us, that the short and simple record of their lives, that record is very important for them. Right? And it is also very important otherwise also. And let not grandeur, let not ambition make fun or look down upon the simple lives of these villagers. Okay, so this is these four paragraphs. You can say, clearly see that it is a simple description of the simple life, simple joys of ordinary people. And the poet very specifically is trying to reprimand all the rich people, or reprimand all the powerful people, that you should not make fun of these ordinary simple people. Why? We'll find out the reason in the next passages. In the following passages, we'll come to know that why the poet is saying this. Why the poet says that this comparison, or this looking down upon, or this disregard, or this, you know, kind of pompous attitude that the rich and powerful people have, they should not have that kind of an attitude towards these poor people. This is what the poet is trying to tell us. And why the poet is trying to say this? Why is he, you know, emphasizing this? This we shall learn later in the poem. So, I hope things are clear. The word meanings are very clear on the screen. Please go through them. I'll end now. And tomorrow I'll again see you and explain the rest of the poem. This is a pretty long poem. So, dear students, please keep your patience and attend to all the videos that I share with you. This is an extremely important poem. It is a landmark poem. So, and personally, I like this poem I like it a lot. So, I would love to share it further with you. Please stay tuned. See you again soon. Bye-bye.